Bleach episode 20, Kenpachi versus Gremmy. Did it live up to the hype? Did it break the internet? Is it the best episode of the core? This is what we're going to be talking about in this episode of the review. And surprisingly enough, it's a little bit controversial. So if you like these type of reviews, hit that like and subscribe and let's get into it, shall we? This episode as a whole had a lot of eyes looking towards this episode. And what do I mean by that? Kenpachi versus Gremmy has always been a fight that people have always wanted to see animated, especially to have that meteor scene kind of given to us, considering its predecessors such as One Piece and Naruto also had meteor scenes, and it kind of paved the way for what meteor scenes are, well, today in anime. But before I get into the controversies, I do want to talk about if I liked the episode or not, to which, if you saw my live reaction, it was genuine, and I always like to come at live reactions as a fan first and as a critic later, because as the critic inside of me for these type of videos. So did I enjoy the episode? Absolutely. Was it fun? Absolutely. Was it beautiful? Absolutely. And was it everything that I wanted within this fight? Yeah, for the majority of the part, like 99% of it was the cool factor, and that's what you expect from a Kenpachi episode. Now, of course, was it better than episode 19, Rookie versus Asuna? Oh, that's a difficult question for me to answer, and many people will say yes, it was, and many people will say no, it wasn't. And the reason for that is that these two episodes are just different on so many levels. One is quite a theatrical horror, while the other one is just ugga bugga fight scenes, right? Now, was the majority of the episode action-packed? Yeah, for the majority of it, and most of it was high action. My favorite scenes were animated, such as the guns, which were in CG and they looked quite nice in CG. Of course, the meteor, which was absolutely great in and of itself, because it wasn't just the meteor, it had some emotional ties to it, going with Yachiru. And of course, it didn't end there. We also had Kenpachi thrown into the vacuum of space, which of course power scalers went nutty over. But then again, I have to ask you guys, does it actually matter? You've got your galaxies in the manga, do you really need it in the anime? And stars are stars at the end of the day. To even, you know, do you know how big space is? The fact that Gremmy was able to imagine something to that magnitude is pretty huge in and of itself. But I'm not going to assume what the power scalers of anime are really saying in regards to this episode, because it's a little bit irrelevant to me. The fact is, Gremmy do be strong. Or weak, maybe. Not only did we get Yachiru's Shikai being seen for the first time, the difference of seeing Yachiru really cheerful and then going to this really, like, sadistic face of, like, she's gonna kill the fuck out of you kind of eyes where all the life went out of it. But seeing Yachiru fight for the first time was really compelling and really fun to see. Isane's voice acting when telling Gremmy to get out of that portal felt like it had a lot of severity to that voice. And then for the majority of the episode, we do see Gremmy just showcase why he's so strong, and I think Kenpachi is the best person for that. Of course, the mental mind games as well going on with his opponent. This is an opponent that can imagine his enemy to literally die at the thought of it. So why didn't he do it against Kenpachi is what some people are saying. Which, if you are saying that, you've completely missed the point of the entire episode as a whole. And I will say there was something just really compelling against seeing that red sky scenery. The backgrounds were gorgeous, and especially the lighting from the meteor absolutely shining off this new stage that Gremmy had created was just pure cinema to me. It was fantastic. But I guess that's not really what I want to talk about, because the complaints are about numerous amount of things. Like, they're small things, because I think everybody enjoyed the episode for the majority of the part, but there is multiple small things that I guess have turned it into a big thing. Let's talk about the context of this episode, and something I kind of maybe want to damage control or give a different perspective on. Whether you agree with it or not, it's completely up to you, but you have to understand, in animation especially, Kenpachi is a rugged guy. His face is not easy to keep on model, and nor is his body, nor is his sword, and nor is his captain's clothing in general. It's quite beat up and quite detailed in of itself. That being said, to do high animation on Kenpachi would either lose deterioration of detail over the fact of high animation. And do you know what I noticed within this episode? That every shot that I had seen was detailed to the absolute fuck of it. You could pause anywhere on this episode and it is going to be highly detailed. So I, for one, was extremely impressed with the levels of animation that they did while keeping the art consistent and sharp. So please take that into consideration when talking about this episode and whether you liked it or not, or whether you wanted more animation or not. I, for one, felt it was good for what it was. I think for a one-to-one manga adaptation, it was fantastic. The disappointing aspect for me personally is that you had this episode which had this massive creative freedom for animators, key animators, and even the director to throw in things that weren't included in the manga. But if this is what Kubo wanted, as Kubo does review the scripts and he does review things or the layouts and the storyboards before these things go into production, then if Kubo's happy with it, then he's happy with it. And that's his vision, and I can't really go against that. Of course, the problem is that we all wanted more from this episode. And that's not entirely a bad thing, because as I finished the episode, I wanted it to not end, because it was so fun and because it was so enjoyable. And I imagine a lot of people got that same vibe as well, is that they just didn't want it to end because it felt so fast. And the context of it too is that, let's talk about pacing. People complained that this was about an 8 to 9 episode or chapter in going into this episode. Now, I imagine most of the Bleach fandom have read the manga. I think people forget that when they were reading this weekly, if you was a weekly reader, you had 8 to 9 to even 10 weeks of experience in this fight. Every week was something new, it was different, it was creative. So we were waiting 10 weeks getting involved with Kenpachi versus Gremmy, and there was an investment there. However, with the anime, you don't have that investment because it is quick. And it was the same with Aznot to some certain degree, but the investment was Rukia and Aznot, because Aznot was shown within Core 1 and we got to be introduced to his character. We got to see how fearsome he was. He made a big impact with Byakuya, whereas with Gremmy, we don't. This is his only episode that he's ever in anything. Maybe he turns up in Can't Fear Your Own World for a flashback, potentially, right? But there was no build up to him, except for like seeing him in the like round table of Quinces, which he was there. But besides that, we don't really know anything about him. We don't, you know, get a build up to him. We don't see how powerful he is by him demonstrating his threat level to another captain. He just turns up and then he's gone. So who are we invested in? Well, we're mainly invested in Kenpachi. And maybe that's why people care more about episode 19 than 20, because there is more of an investment level there. And that's on Kubo's part, not really much the animation's part. Now, for the anime to adapt 10 chapters within one episode, I was always thinking about this episode as, where would they do the cutoff point? If they were really going to postpone this and make it longer into 2 episodes, where would they do the cutoff? Well, surely it's just before the meteor scene and they would cut off the episode there. But then you would realistically be adding a lot more fight into Yatru versus Gwenriel, whatever his name is. And then, of course, more conversation with Gremmy and maybe some extra creativeness with like different imaginative things. But then it would kind of drag out a little bit for a guy that just does imagination. So would I feel that that sits right? It's difficult to say. I'm not a director and we can only unironically imagine what that could possibly be. But I do think it was the right choice. And then you have to talk about cutting pieces of dialogue. Again, a lot was added into this episode and it was quite one-to-one from start all the way to the post end credits at the very end. Are we missing out things such as Basby getting stressed out, Harshworld getting stressed out, Pepe's, I guess, first introduction, I guess you could say, to some degree anyway, like preferably I don't want him on screen, but I mean, you guys do you. There was a sense of war within this episode, or chapters, I should say, because when Gremmy does use the meteor, a lot of the Sternritters, the Soul Reapers, and just the whole battlefield for a moment stops in awe and scared when looking at this meteor that's about to crash down and literally obliterate everything. Why Harshworld would be stressed in this situation is because His Majesty Yuha is sleeping, so he can't really defend himself. So it was a big deal at its time to see everybody's reactions, and I do get it. I understand why people are upset that these things did get taken out. However, to play devil's advocate, I will give you the other perspective of, well, anime really accelerates the threat level by music, by motion, by effects of how big this meteor is, breaking through the barrier, the effects that the barrier created, and the sheer size of it as a whole. Sometimes it is better to show and not tell, but whichever perspective you look at it, I think it's something for everybody, right? But I'm more on the fence of like, yeah, they shouldn't have taken out the dialogue, and I'm with you guys on that. It did bad. But then again, it would probably take around about 20 to 30 seconds to add that dialogue in, and did they have time considering what was given in this episode? Not really. Unless we start really removing ending songs like we did in episode 19. Is this a choice that should be done? I at this point think so. There's a lot to go on, and if you're going to adaptate that many chapters, I think you should. Fate can do it, Kimetsu no Yaiba can do it, you did it for episode 19, why can't we do it again for episode 20? I understand that there's TV broadcasting differences, but I agree, it should have. But let's talk about Gremy as a character. I actually really like Gremy, not because his ability is OP, but the irony. And I'm noticing a theme with all the Stone Riders is that there is a big amount of irony, especially with Asnot. You know, his fear was of death. It wasn't of, like, you know, upsetting Yuha. It was like he didn't want to die. That was his fear. In Gremy's case, the irony is that, as Askin says, is that people with imaginations are dangerous, and it's quite peaceful when those imaginations don't come into fruition, right? In a nutshell, anyway. The great thing with Gremy is that we always say in the real world, you know, in this world that we're speaking in, is that children always have the best imaginations. As you get older, that imagination kind of dwindles because you grow up and then, like, you know, responsibilities and whatnot. But with Gremy, he is basically, I wouldn't say he's a child, but he's definitely still a kid. He's not like an adult or anything like that. So it fits perfectly for his character of all this imagination, right? He also mentions that he's been so strong that no one's ever really wanted to lay a finger on him. So Kenpachi kind of wanting to fight him and not give really a worry about what Gremy's going to do to him was new and vibrant to Gremy, right? It goes to show how easily, in a sense, that Gremy is manipulated. Gremy is the perfect character for this because he has a flaw. As I say, if you want to give the ability of imagination to someone like Aizen, someone like Kisuke, someone like Mayuri, they would probably use it very dangerously, right? Not only dangerously, but calculatively, and they would probably keep their emotions in check. Well, Gremy is the best person to have this ability because God knows how broken that ability is because of the user. He's extremely flawed with it. And the irony is that at the very start, when you see Kenpachi, well, when Gremy sees Kenpachi for the first time, he says exactly what he says. I imagined you would be a strong opponent. So we already had this mindset on what Kenpachi was. So because of that, Kenpachi is strong, but in his head, Kenpachi is stronger than him or is a worthy match for him. That's why he doesn't imagine his bones to be like cookies. That's why he doesn't imagine him dead, because he's curious in his head. He's curious to see how strong this Kenpachi is, because that's what the Darton said. That's what probably Yuha said with, like, the five war potentials. He's been built up within Gremy's head to be a powerful person that he wants to try out. And ultimately, why did Gremy die at the end? Which was quite ironic as well, because if you read the text of what Gremy says, is like, again, paraphrasing, it's hard to imagine a world where there's no imagination in it. And when you think about that, he already imagined that he couldn't imagine anymore. So because of that, like, he kind of offed himself in a sense, because he just imagined that his brain can't imagine anymore. And if his brain can't imagine anymore, then his body won't exist, or anything that he imagined prior won't exist. So the concept alone, he just offed himself, unironically. Mind you, this whole episode, Kenpachi didn't remove his eye patch. So yay, Gremy. I don't think you did imagine correctly, unless you're talking about that specific time. Then maybe Gremy did, in fact, imagine how strong Kenpachi was, and he really couldn't have a body. Now, I do find this to be a little bit incorrect, because I feel like that's Gremy's own copium. I do also feel Gremy's weakness is also the fact that he can't imagine the unimaginable, which means that if you don't know how strong somebody is, or you don't know something and you're trying to imagine something you don't actually know, then it's going to be flawed within itself. And I think, you know, when it comes to broken abilities, I mean, we see it in shonen and we see it in fiction all the time. It's great to give someone, like, broken abilities. I think even Kishimoto at one point said, you know, Madara was so strong that he couldn't kill him off at some point. And you look at someone like Gojo, like, these guys are, like, a strong characters. And I do feel what Kubo does best is that he really plays with the concept of how strong can I make this character, but also figures out a way to make them weak at the same time, whether it be user diff or whether it be item diff, right? And we'll talk about that when the miracle comes at some point in the future. The Stone Riders are extremely powerful, and it's not all about fighting, it's also about mind games. And the great thing about Kenpachi is he doesn't even realize he's doing mind games with him. He's always just challenging him, and that's what Gremy had never had before. So it really just was a character diff. It really was just, like, just wrong matchup, which is great because Kenpachi is a tank, and I mean, breaking out of, you know, space is a feat in of itself. But it's like, well, what does Nuzurashi do? What's its ability? Well, I mean, we could always go on the concept of, like, he did say there's nothing in your imagination that I can't cut. I'm not a power scaler, and I'm not going to try to. I haven't even looked at, like, Kenpachi's Shikai Bankai for, like, a while, right? I know what his Bankai does, but I never really looked at his Shikai. So I imagine it just has the ability to cut through things that he thinks is cuttable, maybe? I don't know. I've seen a lot of people say there's a reishi diff, which is, if you guys don't know what that means, it means that, like, when Aizen mentions that, like, he has a stronger ryatsu than another person, then the other person's abilities become nullified. I do struggle with this concept a lot, because that would imply that the Soul King's brain, which, again, a bit of a novel spoiler, and trust me, it's a bit of a spoiler for me too, because I haven't really indulged myself too much in the novels, but I know that Gremmy's brain, as much as some, like, relationship with Gremmy and Latoto, and I hope that, like, that kind of gets flashbacked if we ever get an adaptation of Can't Feel Your Own World, which Latoto's goaded and I can't wait to see the next episode. But the whole idea that it's the Soul King's brain and then comparing it to Kenpachi's ryatsu is like, do I agree with that? I don't know. I mean, the imagination stuff makes sense because obviously you need a lot of ryatsu to be able to pull off what Gremmy did, right? But lesser than Kenpachi or more than Kenpachi or equal to Kenpachi is like, ooh. You know, it's still the Soul King's brain at the end of the day. It does kind of go against reason sometimes. So I don't know how to feel about that comment. Of course, that's just my opinion. I could be wrong. But overall, I didn't see this episode trend that much in comparison to Rukia's episode. I feel like this was an episode that was maybe underwhelming on the big grand scale of things when it comes to weekly watching. But when it comes to choreography, when it came to on model, when it came to the adaptation, it did its job very well as a one-to-one adaptation. Was there room for creativity? Absolutely. I don't disagree with that. And I don't blame you if you didn't like this episode. But you can't say it's bad. That's for sure. It left a lot to be desired, but, you know, it's still a pretty solid episode. And it's unfortunate because the more I keep thinking about this episode, the more that it makes me confused on whether I like it or not, because there's a lot that I want in it, but there's a lot that it did right. And it's like, I try and look at the context of things, like, what type of episode is it? What did it adaptate? What could it have done better? How would I have done it better? And it's like, it's difficult. So, it's not really much of a review, but a conversation starter. So, that being said, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day, be dancing, and as always, people, peace out.